And we're still in that first section of Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, concerning itself with the household of God, just the family of God, and how we're to relate to one another. So allow me to just set the context by reading those verses, and then we'll get into the text. There in verse 1, the Apostle Paul says, "But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. Older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Older women likewise are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good. And so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works, and in your teaching show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. Slaves are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They are to be well-pleasing and not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior." C.H. Spurgeon once observed a drunken man leaning up against a lamppost. In slurred speech, the drunk told him, he said, "Mr. Spurgeon, do you remember me?" To which he said, "Why should I?" And the man replied, "Well, I'm one of your disciples." And Spurgeon responded, he says, "You must be one of mine because you're certainly not one of the Lord's." Now, these past few weeks, we've been looking again at the household of God. And I'm convinced that in reality, what it is, you know, we're looking at older men and older women and relating to younger people and this and that, and the preacher's supposed to preach the word. But ultimately, what we're talking about here is how we're to make disciples within the church, how we're supposed to disciple one another. And if I might be so bold as to suggest that, look, if Spurgeon could admit to failure in this most essential aspect of our Christian life, this essential commandment, go make disciples, if he can admit failure like we just read, then perhaps we can admit our own shortcomings in our personal lives and for us as a church as a whole. And so this morning we're going to be looking at the two ways we are to make disciples within the household of God. And my intent this morning is really to enable all of us. Now, given the context, it's really, there's only one thing said to the young men, because that's what you were all expecting, at least I assume. Like, okay, this is going to be about young guys, and we're going to beat up on these guys and get them all figured out, right? But there's really only one thing that's said to them, right? He says, "I urge you to tell them, you know, to be self-controlled," which is like herding cats. But that's the only thing he tells them to do with the young men. And then the rest of it is all directed towards the elder. It's all directed again towards Titus. And here now we get the picture of what it looks like to disciple a young man. And I think in general, it's a picture of how you and I are to disciple one another within the context of the church. And so all of this applies to each and every one of us. This isn't just about preachers discipling young men or what have you. This is about the household of God, older men, older women, young men, all of us, and pastors included, elders in there, discipling one another. And these are some of the core things that have to be done. And so what I want to do for you this morning is for you to answer a few questions. You can jot these down or just keep them in mind. And here they are. One, who is discipling me? Who is it in Grace Hill Church? Maybe I'm not even a member, but I show up all the time. I'm sitting in a pew. I'm listening to sermons. Maybe I go to TC group, you know, to our small groups. I know some people here. Who is pouring their life into me? Let me just tell you this. If you've been coming here to this church for a long period of time, member or not, and someone has not approached you in regards to like, "Hey, can I pray for you? Hey, can I go hang out with you, find out who you are, and to see how we can disciple one another?" If that's not happened, that's our bad, that's our sin. Because that's what the church is supposed to be about. It's not all about entertainment to where you can live in isolation, where you can be an anonymous Christian and just kind of slip in and slip out. You did your 45 minutes or whatever. It's supposed to be this, a family interacting with one another with a purpose, the purpose of discipling one another, which means this, to grow in Christ's likeness and in godliness. That's what's supposed to be happening. So the question is, who is discipling me? Nobody? I'm going to go talk to an elder because I want to grow in my faith. Here's the second question. Who am I discipling? Because I'm in this household, I've got it all figured out. I've read these 10 verses like a million times, you know, because Tim just keeps going back to it. So I know that in this household of God, we're supposed to be relating to one another with a purpose. I know I have a purpose right here at Grace Hill. That is to pour my life into someone else so that they can grow, not to be exactly like me, God forbid, but rather to be more like Jesus Christ. Who am I discipling? And what this really puts on all of us is this, is that this isn't a sit-down church. This is a place to come and get busy, to do the work of the ministry. Ephesians chapter 4, the elders are supposed to train and to encourage and enable God's people within the household, old men, old women, young women, to do the work of the ministry. This is the work of the ministry, pouring your life into one another. And so there's the first two questions. Who's discipling me? Who am I discipling? And the next question is, how do I go about doing it? And that's really what we're going to answer right here. How do I go about discipling somebody? So let's get started as we look at these two ways we are to make disciples within the household of God. First of all, you must be a godly example in order to make a disciple. Look at verses 6-8 with me again. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works, and in your teaching show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. So the first thing I want to do is help us understand this word self-controlled there in verse 6. We're going to look at its definition. We'll see how it applies to young men and who really are the exact opposite of self-control, right? And when they happen to be self-controlled, it's because God has done some kind of crazy miracle in their life. We know this. And then lastly, I want to show how being self-controlled is intimately related to being a disciple of Christ or making a disciple. Okay, so self-controlled, it comes from the Greek word sophroneo, and it basically means to be in one's right mind, which then enables you to act appropriately, to make wise and godly decisions. And it's used really in a remarkable way in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. In fact, turn there with me real quickly, beginning in verse 1, Mark chapter 5, verse 1, and you're going to see exactly how this plays out. Mark chapter 5, verse 1, they, meaning our Lord and his disciples, the apostles, they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. I'm sure I'm butchering that, forgive me. Verse 2, and when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. And he lived among the tombs. And no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs on the mountains, he was always crying out and bruising himself with stones. Now that kind of describes young men, yeah? For instance, when my sons were all teenagers, which by the way was all four of them at the same time, and I highly recommend you do that, by the way, raise young men all at the same time, the same age basically. So four teenage boys all at once. If you do that, you'll learn to pray without ceasing. You'll have a new walk with God that you could have never had before. And so when I would walk into their bedrooms, it was like stepping right into the tombs of Mark chapter 5. The yelling, the screaming, the smells, you know, it was that. Of course, we know the rest of the story, at least back in Mark chapter 5. Jesus cast the demons, plural, out of this man, and then we're told, skip down if you will, Mark 5 verse 15. Look at what it says. And they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had had the legion sitting there, clothed, and here it is, in his right mind. They were afraid. That little phrase there, in his right mind, it is the same exact Greek word, sophroneo, or self-control, that Paul has used in Titus chapter 2, verse 6. So then, how is this related to making disciple? I mean, we see the picture now, right? Mark 5, demon-possessed man, uncontrollable, out of his mind, and suddenly, because of the grace of Christ, he's self-controlled. He's thinking correctly. How does this relate to making a disciple? We get our first hint right there at the end of Mark 5, or rather, in Mark 5, verse 18 and following. Look at what it says there, and you'll see it. As he, meaning Jesus, was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends, tell them how much the Lord has done for you, and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and he began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. Now then, if that right there, if that doesn't describe a disciple, a disciple that follows Jesus Christ, gives his will to his Lord's, because he had a will, right? He's like, "I want to stay with you." "No, you don't. You're gonna go do this." "Okay, Lord." He's a follower of Christ. He's a disciple. So if that doesn't describe a disciple, I don't know what does. Jesus had cast out his demons. This man was now in his right state of mind. And I would argue that somewhere in the midst of all of this, even though it's unstated, somewhere in the midst of all this, he was saved. He was self-controlled, and as a result, he wanted to be where Jesus was. But his Lord and Savior had different plans for him. "You're going to go home, tell them who I am and what I've done for you." Amen. He goes. Because he's a follower. He's a disciple. So what does this tell us about being self-controlled? Well, first of all, it tells us that having self-control is not simply the result of being a disciple. Because this is the way we look at it, okay? I prayed a prayer, I became a Christian, and now as a result, I now have some kind of sense of self-control, and I'm able to combat the sins of my past and overcome them. And that's true to a certain extent. But here in Mark 5, we get this impression that he was out of his mind, he was out of control, the demon-possessed man, the unsaved man, and suddenly, Jesus, if you will, gives him his mind back. And now, as a result of this grace, of being able to think clearly, because you see, salvation isn't just about your spirit. It is about your mind, your body, your soul. He saves all of you. Everything is redeemed about you. And so this is what's going on. His mind is now able to focus. And now he's able to see, or evidently he was able to see, "I am filled with sin and I need Jesus Christ." This is what it tells us about self-control. It is a gift of God that enables you for the first time in your life to think clearly about who you are, a sinner who is spiritually dead, walking among the tombs, a sinner in need of a Savior. And now your eyes are open to Christ, your one and only hope of salvation. And finally you see him and understand who he is and what he has done for you. This is what Jesus commanded him to go and share with all of his folks. "Don't come physically following me. Go back home. Go and tell them who I am and what I have done." And so he did. And so with this new mind of self-control, he understood that Jesus was fully God and fully man. He is the one that lived a sinless life. He is the one that died on the cross for his sins and rose from the grave 3 days later. And he, somewhere in the midst of all of that, repented of his sins and trusted in Jesus Christ. And he was gloriously and eternally saved. All because God, Jesus, gave him his mind back, self-controlled. As a result of God giving you self-control, you now have the blessings of being saved and growing in your following of Christ. growing as a disciple of Christ, because you have to have a mind that is able to focus on Christ. Look, no one is beyond hope. I think that's something that we need to take away from that Mark 5 text, right? Because I'm assuming that most of you know somebody that would like, yeah, my son, my daughter, my friend, my cousin, whomever, he could be the demon-possessed guy of Mark 5. You might even think yourself, like, I can't get it all together. And you know what the answer is? You're right. You can't. You never will. Until Jesus shows up and gives you your sense of self-control, enables you by his grace to look at who you really are and what you truly deserve, which is an eternity in hell, and look to him alone for salvation. So no one is beyond hope. Even, if you will, going back to Titus 2:6, even young men who are often immature, impatient, arrogant, and self-willed. God has and will continue to make disciples of young men in all types, old men, old women, along with the young men and young women who are more times than not out of control and spiritually undisciplined. And so what this tells us is that our Father's love, when once he has set it upon you, is inescapable. His saving power, irresistible. His sovereign grace, immutable. And he's called us to make disciples. And it begins the moment God causes a young man or otherwise to be in their right state of mind and then to have self-control. It's not for you to convince or put them on a guilt trip. You go and just share the gospel. God does this self-control part. Now then, everything else that we're going to look at is through this lens of discipleship. Okay, so the young men, urge them to be self-controlled. In other words, share the gospel. Jesus is going to show up and save them and give them the right state of mind. So now you have a fertile place for them to grow in Christ-likeness. And so really, again, what we're trying to answer is a simple question. How do you make a disciple? And of course, the first answer is be a godly example. God has done the initial work. He's saved them. He's given them their mind back. And now it's up to us to be a godly example in their life. So that, with that in mind, let's go back to our text, Titus chapter 2, verse 6. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. First of all, we need to understand that making of a disciple is something God has called all of us to do. Therefore, these disciple-making principles, they apply to all of us. But here in our text, Paul is talking specifically to the lead teaching elder of the church, Titus. And I think the reason Paul singles out Titus for this task in the household of God is due to the fact that it is from these wild and typically uncontrollable young men God has chosen to not only disciple as followers of Christ, but to call as the future elders of the church. Do you guys see that? I mean, we all pour into each other's lives, yes. But it is specifically the elders of the church that are always supposed to have an eye towards the young men of the church for the sake of not only discipling, I want you to grow in your faith, but they're trying to discern in who is God going to call. So that then I could go the extra mile, if you will. So then I can pour my life into, because someday I won't be here, someone needs to come and fill this pulpit and lead this church and lead our worship. And do you see what I'm talking about? And I think that that's what's going on here. You know, Bible colleges, seminaries, they didn't exist back in the day, and I'm not suggesting that they are illegitimate or unbiblical or anything like that. They are a gift of training and knowledge for the church as a whole. But their greatest weakness is found right here. The seminary experience limits the opportunity for the existing elders of a church to not only personally disciple young men, they lose that motive to do it, right? Like, why do I need to pour into you? Oh, you feel called? Great. I hope you have money and a car and a place to live somewhere far away so you can go to seminary. That's basically it. I don't find that anywhere in Scripture. And so the Bible college, the seminary experience can limit our motive as elders or as a church to pour into the lives of the young men of our own church. That's somebody else's job, and I hope you have money to do it, kind of attitude. And so we're not motivated to really cultivate them, invest in them as new potential elders. And so this is why Paul speaks directly to Titus in verse 7. Look at what it says there. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. In other words, don't send them off somewhere. You're the one. You show them what it's like to be a disciple of Christ. And perhaps some of them will be elders later on. Because if you remember back in Titus chapter 1, that is specifically what Paul had left Titus to do on Crete. It was to cultivate and invest in these future elders. Here's what their characteristics are supposed to look like. Here's the gifts that they're supposed to have. And so now this is a part of how you do it. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. What Paul's referring to here is every aspect of your life, or in this case, in the life of the elder Titus. So now we're talking about the totality of his being, his thoughts, his words, and his deeds. What you think in the privacy of your own thoughts matters, because those thoughts inform and influence what comes out of your mouth and ultimately the way you act on a daily basis. The way you live your life, the words that come out of your mouth, even the very thoughts you dwell on throughout the day, these are a model or to be a model for others to follow. They're not just yours. The word for model in the Greek is tupos, and in this context, it refers to living in such a manner that if others followed your example, they would grow in Christ-likeness, they would grow in godliness. And this is seen in texts just like in 1 Corinthians 11:1, it says, "And you should follow my example." Paul saying this to the Corinthians, "You should follow my example just as I follow Christ's." In other words, if you follow mine, it's going to lead you not to me, but to Christ. Now, I know most of you are thinking, you know, Tim, I come to church, but I'm not here to be anybody's example. I didn't sign up for that. Here's the rub. You cannot have that kind of attitude biblically. Because we've just seen it, Titus chapter 2, 1 through 10, it doesn't allow us the easy way out. It doesn't allow us to clean our hands and step back like, yeah, you don't follow me. Don't look to me. I'm no influencer. I'm no model for you. That attitude is simply unbiblical, and I'm tempted to go so far as to say sinful. So where is it that we got this idea of like, hey, I'm no one's example, not even in the church? Well, I believe it stems from the worldly influences on the church that have crept into the church. And first of all, there's no denying that the world, it worships at the temple of self, right? And the world has conditioned us to believe that everything we do is for our own personal happiness and is protected from scrutiny by our sense of personal privacy. And this includes our relationship with God. We hear it all the time, don't we? You know, my religious beliefs, my spiritual beliefs, that's between me and my God. You hear that all the time. And sometimes you even hear it in the church. You can hear this kind of echoed. It's changed a little bit within the church, but you can hear this in the church today. I made Jesus, and it's funny, I love how they put it too. I made Jesus my personal Savior, as though he had no choice in the matter whatsoever. I have a personal relationship with God, and no doubt we do have a relationship with God. We enter into that by faith in Jesus Christ, but biblically, that relationship is lived out, not hidden in isolation, in seclusion, where nobody gets to interject anything or to evaluate or to celebrate nothing. It doesn't work like that. When you come into a relationship with God, your Father, He immediately adopts you as His own and puts you in His household. Now you live under my roof. And oh yeah, these are all your brothers and sisters. Get to know them. Learn to love them. Because now this is your home. That's the way it works. That's the reality of it. Not this personal one-on-one with nobody looking in, us not having any kind of conversations with people. That's the way we want it to be. Like it or not, your brothers and sisters in Christ, because they're under the same roof, are looking to you as an example. Your thoughts, your words, and deeds leave a lasting impression upon everybody around you. So my question to you is this: what kind of example of thought, word, and deed are you showing to your brothers and sisters in Christ? Because it's having an impact. What kind of an example are you being? You may be real self-defensive. Don't look to me as an example. Sorry. Biblically, that just doesn't fly. You are. So what are you leaving behind? Now then, the one demanded by Scripture, the kind of example you're supposed to share is found there in verse 7. Look at it again. Show yourself in all respects, thought, word, and deed, to be a model of good works. Now that's an interesting little phrase, because we find throughout the Scriptures, you know, there's good works, then there's just works. And so have you ever wondered what's the difference between works and good works? They actually look like the same thing from the outside. You can read your Bible, you can take care of people in need, you can share the gospel, you can pray. All of those things essentially look the same from the outside. But what separates good works from just simple works is the motivation behind them. For instance, in Hebrews 10:24, there we're encouraged to stir up one another to love and good works. And this kind of informs what really is going on behind the scenes with good works. Good works look the same as works, but they're done out of love for God and for one another. Do you guys see the difference? Works just do this. I'm doing this so that someday I can stand before God and tell Him, you owe me. Why? Well, because I taught that Awana's class that nobody wanted, man. And so, you know, that's me. So you owe me one. Matthew 7:21-23, Jesus says that on the day of judgment, many will try to vindicate themselves in front of Him. How? By pointing to good works. Hey, I prayed, I preached, I cast out demons, I did all of these things, you owe me. And this is what He's going to tell them: I never knew you, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. But I did good things. Yep, for the wrong reason. So that you could come here and brag in front of me. So that you could come here and tell me that you are so good that I have to love you. I owe you. Wrong. Those are just mere works. By the way, with that in mind, where are you at? Why do you pray? Why are you here at church this morning? What is really going on in your heart? Is it to make up for the sins of the week? Is it to make up for all your wrongdoing, even last night? Like, you know, I got to come and make this right. God will then owe me. He will then love me again. What is your motive? That's what you really need to be asking yourself all the time when you do anything that you consider good. What defines it is the motive. Lord, I'm going to do this. Why? Not so that I can make up for anything or that you can owe me later, but because I love you and I love these people, my family, and even unsaved people. Always ask yourself why. Good works are done out of love for God and for each other. Works are done out of love for yourself. So take care how you live in the household of God. Your father, your family is watching. Don't simply go through the motions of godliness. Show your brothers and sisters how to love God in thought, word, and deed. That's the demand here. Not just works, but good works done out of love. That's the model that you need to be, the example that's worthy of following, the example that will lead them to Christ's likeness. Because isn't this how Jesus was motivated to obey his Father? All out of love for his Father and for the sinners, you and me, that he died for. Now then, secondly, not only must you be an example in order to make a disciple, but you must be a biblical teacher in order to make a disciple. Look at verses 6 through 8 again. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. And then he switches gears into teaching. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. Now, obviously, this was intended for Titus because, again, he's the teaching elder, at least in the formal sense, on Sunday morning worship. But what does the Great Commission say, and who is that directed towards? You don't have to turn there. I'm just going to read it. It's Matthew 28, verses 19 through 20. It says, "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations." Now, in the context, that was spoken to the apostles and a bunch of the disciples, and Jesus is about to ascend back to the Father. But with that said, it's intended for all Christians of all times, all of us. And so he's telling us, go, as you go about living your life, make disciples, share the gospel, and then who are you going to make disciples of? All nations, all sorts of people, not just the ones you're comfortable with, that are your race or economic level or what have you, all kinds of people, all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Not that it saves them, but it's recognition that they belong to their Father and to this fellowship. They're okay with being a part of this family, wherever that may be. And then verse 20, it says, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. That is directly directed, this commandment to not only go and make disciples, but to teach, is directed not just at elders, not just at apostles, but each and every one of us. And so by that definition, all of us here are teachers by our example and by the things that come out of our mouths. So again, this commandment is not just for elders. It's for all of us. Of course, that doesn't mean we're all preachers, or even teachers in the sense of leading a study or a class here at the church. In fact, James chapter 3, verse 1 warns us pretty sternly. It says, "Not many of you should become teachers." Why? "For you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness." So that's why we're not just like, you know, free pulpit Sunday, you know, like everybody get up here and give us a... There's churches that do that. But we're not going to anytime soon, Brother Root. I'm sorry if that infringed on any aspirations you had. But James 3 tells us real clearly, you know, you don't do that. That's why there should only be a handful of preachers and teachers in that formal sense. But make sure you understand this. All of you are called to make disciples, to share the gospel with others, and to teach them what Jesus did and who he was. Teach them the word. And I would dare say what this means is more along the lines of the one-on-one or in a small group setting or something where you're visiting a family and you're pouring into them or to that individual, the older woman with the young woman and vice versa, what have you. And so what we have are these discipleship-making moments. And there's your example, your life, and then it's what you're talking about. I mean, you're not just exchanging recipes or talking about football. And it's funny because for a lot of churches, that's about as far as we go in our relationships with one another. I mean, I can think back with most of the relationships as a church member that I had, it never really got onto anything deeper than, you know, our likes and dislikes. How's your family? How's your favorite team? And it's just this social thing. And I'm not saying that that's all wasted time, but it certainly isn't what we're talking about here. We're supposed to be teaching, pouring scripture into one another's lives. And you don't have to be behind a pulpit in order to do that. So make sure you understand, you're called to do this as well. In your one-on-one conversations, in just hanging out with people that you know and love here at the church. Your life, by example and by the depth that you go into your conversations, are always intended to make a difference for the kingdom, to be an investment of God's word at some juncture. Now then, with that said, given the context that we have here, I'm going to focus on the elders from here on out and how they're supposed to go about doing it, understanding that it applies to you as well, because you're a teacher as well to a certain extent. This is what it takes. This is the kind of teaching it takes to make a disciple. First of all, it must show integrity. What this means is that it's sound. For example, if you were the captain of a ship, and I know we're out here in the desert, so this is a really horrible illustration, but, you know, if you had a houseboat, you know, out at Navajo Lake, at some point, you would want somebody to check the hull, and that's what this term really refers to, that it's watertight, that it's seaworthy, that it's dependable, trustworthy. That's what integrity means. Failure to do so can lead to tragedy. So we should all know where this is headed to. This isn't about your integrity as a person, so much as it is the source of your teaching. So this goes right back to the Bible. Because you know what? Our hearts are always, even the best of us, our hearts somewhere, somehow, is tainted by sin. Therefore, there are small leaks in us all the time. We have no integrity in the truest sense of the word. Not the way Paul is using it here. When he's talking about, hey, make sure you have integrity, what he's saying is, make sure you're teaching and preaching the Bible. That's what he's saying. Because it is sound, it is seaworthy, it is trustworthy. Go there time and time again. Don't trust in your own wisdom, even your own experiences. Always go back to the truth, to God's word. You see, the integrity of the preaching and teaching, for instance, here at Grace Hill, it is established and ensured not by the so-called talent behind the pulpit, because I assure you, at least in my case, there is none, zero. The integrity of what happens here and at any church rests solely upon Scripture alone. Spurgeon has this amazing quote, which really brings this truth home. I started off with him. I want to read this. It's kind of long, so just stay focused with me, and you'll really hear this. He says, "Oh, that you and I might get into the very heart of the Word of God and get that Word into ourselves, as I have seen the silkworm eat into the leaf and consume it, so ought we to do with the Word of the Lord, not crawl ever its surface, but eat right into it till we have taken it into our inmost parts. It is idle merely to let the eye glance over the words, or to recollect the poetical expressions or the historic facts. But it is blessed to eat into the very soul of the Bible until at last you come to talk in scriptural language, and your very style is fashioned upon scripture models, and what is better still, your spirit is flavored with the words of the Lord." And he continues, "I would quote John Bunyan as an instance of what I mean. Read anything of his, and you will see that it is almost like reading the Bible itself. He had studied our authorized version, which will never be bettered, as I judge, till Christ shall come. He had read it till his very soul was saturated with Scripture, and though his writings are charmingly full of poetry, yet he cannot give us his Pilgrim's Progress, that sweetest of all prose poems, without continually making us feel and say, 'Why, this man is a living Bible.' Cut him anywhere, his blood is bibline. The very essence of the Bible flows from him. And that's an amazing statement, an amazing quote. Only Spurgeon can do these kind of things. But what he was encouraging us to do is to be so well acquainted with God's word, to be so saturated by God's word that now our words sound just like scripture. We're using the same phrases, the same what have you. It just sounds like scripture. It's flavored with it. Our very soul is flavored with it. Cut us and we bleed biblically. He invented a word there. We bleed the Bible. That's who we have to be if we're going to make disciples. This is the kind of teaching that God uses and demands in order to make disciples. It's not enough to know every chapter and verse word for word. It's not enough to be relevant and entertaining. You have to be transformed yourself by the word. And by the way, this is in fact relevant to everyone here. This isn't just about the preaching of Grace Hill. Fathers, this is for you. You want to raise up disciples in your home? You want your children to love God, to be different than you, to be different than the way you were raised? Then you had best eat the word of God and consume it daily and be transformed by it. So that when you speak, your children hear not so much you, but the very voice of God. That's what's going to change their lives. You moms raising your little ones, you know, it always says behind every great man, there's, you know, there's a woman, yeah, but there's probably a mom that really instilled all of these values and characteristics into their children, into their sons and daughters, and you have a part in making a disciple as well, right in your home. So what kind of language is flowing out of your mouth? What is it that they're hearing? Turn with me for a moment to 1 Corinthians 2, beginning in verse 1. Here the Apostle Paul, he's talking about his ministry to the Corinthian church. This is what he says, "And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom." There were professional lawyers and speakers back at that time, and they had learned the art of speaking, public speaking. You could go to school for it. And he's saying, I didn't come armed with all of that. "For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." So he was armed to the teeth with the gospel. That was it. "And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling." And so he didn't come out, you know, kicking in doors and like, man, I am the best preacher ever. And I'm just going to show you how to get it done. He's a very humble guy. "And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom." And so it wasn't like he was outlining it like, okay, this is all rational, step one, step two, step three. It all makes sense, doesn't it? No, there's some of it that just like, yeah, that doesn't make sense. Not to me in my natural, sinful, darkened mind. And so he goes on. "My speech, my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith may not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." You see, when it really comes down to it, is if you want to make a disciple, you have to have integrity, meaning you go to the Word, which contains the truth, and you know it so well that that's what comes out of your mouth. It has transformed your soul. You are cut. You bleed biblically. It's just who you are, and that's the voice that they're hearing, the voice of the Lord, and that is the power when he talks about it right there in the end of verse 4. His speech and his message were through the demonstration of the Spirit and the power. It's not because he was, you know, doing all these miraculous things per se. It is because the Word of God was made understandable, attainable, doable, all of that, because the Holy Spirit was enabling sinners whose minds were once darkened to the truth to suddenly understand it, to grasp it. Boom, that's a powerful spiritual experience to go from unbelieving to suddenly going, my eyes are open. Lord, I believe you are my Lord, you are my master. That's it. That is never as the result of a really good preacher. That is always the result of the word being faithfully proclaimed and the Holy Spirit being cut loose to do what he does best, to save sinners and to help disciples grow. And so my constant prayer for myself, for my fellow elders, and for all of you who now know that you're a teacher in your home and your workplace and in your friendships, my constant prayer for all of us is that we would be so saturated, transformed by God's word, that our teaching would bleed Bible. If biblical knowledge were enough, then the Pharisees and the scribes would be our model. If personal charisma were enough, then Joel Osteen would be our model. It must go deeper. You must go deeper till you are broken on the pages of Scripture and your soul refined by its fires. A disciple-making church needs one thing: someone willing to preach the Bible. That's it. No fancy programs. Not all these other things. Just somebody that's willing to go up and say, here's what it means, this is what it looks like, and this is how you do it. Let's do that. Now, of course, there's a bit more in our text, but I'm going to close it up right here. All of us are called to make disciples by our life, by our teaching, because all of us are sons and daughters of our Father, and we live in his house, in his household. So what kind of home, what kind of church do you want to live in? Believe it or not, that's up to you, up to us. The elders of Grace Hill must continue to live and teach in a manner that encourages and enables all of us, the older men and women here, to mentor young men and young women so that our spiritual home will continuously be built up into Christ. And it all stands or falls on this one thing: are we going to make disciples or not? Author Richard Foster has put it like this: the desperate need today is not for a greater number of intelligent people or gifted people, but for deep people. And I would add, a people deeply committed to loving God and loving one another. Committed enough to make disciples of one another, to be open to that in your life, and to do so well. Be an example. Be a teacher. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for what you've shown us here, what we're really supposed to be about. From the preaching in this pulpit to the homes of every believer here, we're supposed to make disciples. We're supposed to be having somebody pour into us ourselves. And so we started with those three questions, you know: who's discipling me, and who am I discipling, and how do I go about it? I pray that those questions were answered for your people today. Because if they're not, then there's really no point. If we're not about making disciples and being discipled, Father, then what are we doing here other than sinning against you? Because that's your command. So I trust that you would allow us, Lord, to be truly committed to this endeavor, knowing it's all of your grace and that you are the one that will enable us to do it. May you bless us now, Father. In Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen. During this time of reflection, what is required of you as we prepare our hearts for communion is to think deeply about what was just preached. Who's discipling me? Who am I going to disciple? How do I go about it? Here's the motive. It's seen in the elements. This is our Father's table. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. And so we come here to be reminded how we got into his house in the first place. All of faith, not because you deserved it, not just because you come to church, but because at some point God enabled you to have self-control and you stepped out from the tombs into eternal life, and you were saved. And how did that happen? Because of Jesus Christ, because he offered up his body as a sacrifice, pointing to the bread, and he died on the cross for your sins, pointing to the fruit of the vine. And so as you come, understand, these are pictures of how you stepped into the household of God, all of faith. And what I want to know from you is, how are you now going to live in God's house? We've got to make disciples. We've got to love God and one another enough to be committed to that. So when you take a moment, confess your sins and repent of them, when you're ready, you come.